testing. Conference. I have the pleasure to introduce Professor Dr. Or Kakhlon, from the Department of Neurology from the Hadassah Hebrew University Medical Center. He will talk with us about using high throughput screening with image-based phenotyping advances and maybe change our way to look at the adult polyglucosan body disease. Please.
Thank you very much for the invitation. So yes, this is the title of my talk. And what I wanted to show you is indeed how high throughput screening can be combined with the approach that Professor White described of image-based phenotyping to shed a new light on incurable disease such as adult polyglucosan body disease. So this is indeed a paradigm. First of all, what is assumed to be the pathogenic factor in adult polyglucosan body disease and its sister disease, Lafora disease? Normally, glycogen, shown here in this simulation to grow from its primary glycogenin, forms as glycosyl units are added sequentially. And you can see the elongation phase. And every about six or seven, or let's say 6 to 8 residues, there's a branching event mediated by glycogen branching enzyme. So if you can see, as you can see in this simulation, if this process is repeated, okay, you receive this globular structure, hydrophilic at its surface, and this is what makes glycogen actually number one soluble and number two available for fast energy release. You know, glycogen is actually the largest organic molecule in the cytosol, consisting of more than 50,000 glucose residues. So this is how it is soluble and usable. So let's run the simulation now without or with reduced activity of the branching enzyme and see what happens. You can see that the branching frequency is much less. There are 7 units without branching. Okay, much less branching. And what you get is this elongated structure, similar to amylopectin, which you can see it's long, it's not soluble. The hydrophilic surface is much smaller, and it stacks together like starch, which is good for potato, good for corn, less good for your axons. And this is how it's shown in the electron microscope. So this is what is supposed to cause the APBD and the Lafora disease. Let's talk a little bit about the clinical differences. Lafora disease is actually also caused by polyglucosans, but it's a completely different neurological disorder. It's a myoclonic epilepsy, progressive myoclonic epilepsy, whereas APBD is ALS-like leukodystrophy. It is caused by different genes. Lafora is caused by genes that actually control glycogen phosphorylation and also glycogen synthesis degradation, because glycogen synthesis is not active actually in the brain. And APBD is caused by deficiency of glycogen branching enzyme. And also the onset is different. Lafora is an adolescent disorder with, so the age of onset is usually about 12, and they go through a terrible ordeal. This is really one of the most difficult diseases with intractable hallucinations and epileptic events. And they usually die in status epilepticus by the age of 20. And you can see here the Lafora bodies and the polyglucosan in APBD, which you can see they clog axons. Okay, and I should say the polyglucosans are also reported in other disorders, but we don't have time. So actually, just to summarize what I said, if you look at the balance between the glycogen synthesis and glycogen branching activity, the higher this ratio, the more likely you are to have polyglucosans and the less likely you are to have glycogen. So this actually, what this slide explains is that the therapeutic strategy usually people take is either to inhibit glycogen synthesis, which as I said is not really needed unless in extreme conditions, it's not really needed in the brain. So either to inhibit glycogen synthesis or to activate or to stabilize the branching enzyme, which is mutated in APBD. Or to degrade the polyglucosans, which is, of course, much more difficult task. So I contacted with Miguel, I think, about 3 years ago. And I told him, let's try a high-throughput screening approach. We can buy a naive drug library. And at the time, the BDCC, the Blavatnik Center, was called CSF-PM. And they had a liquid handling robot, which was conjugated to the INCEL high-throughput microscope. So then and now in the new center, it's a more advanced the version of the INCEL. And what was our readout is that, and the basis of all this screen was that you can identify, selectively identify polyglucosans and differentiate them from glycogen because the polyglucosans are resistant to, the glycogen is not resistant, sorry, rephrase, the polyglucosans are resistant to amylase, okay, which of course degrades glycogen. So if you treat the cells with amylase for a certain period of time at a certain concentration, you can still see the staining in APBD patient cells, but you cannot see it in control cells. And this is a very good basis for high throughput screening, which took us about a year and a half to develop, optimizing many parameters like the diastase or amylase concentration, cell density, etc. So it's really a very time-consuming, very elaborate process of getting to the, with all the necessary control, getting to the right high throughput screening assay. One thing I want to point out, and it's not technical because these things are extremely important because you want to make sure that you are that your readout is what you want, that you're looking at the right entity. So, for instance, we used segmentation. The classical segmentation is based on the nuclear collar, and as you can see here, for instance, it doesn't. Using this nuclear collar will include this structure here as part of the cell, whereas it is evidently a debris. And so instead of using the classical nuclear collar, we used the cell mask, which stains the cytosol, and you can see actually that all the polyglucosans we had are actually cell-associated. For instance, a very good example for a false positive. So we screened drugs for their ability to reduce polyglucosans. If you look, for instance, at this drug, apparently it seems that there is a very nice dose response as it reduces the signal or the staining of the polyglucosans. However, this actually shows reduction in cell area. So we had to also take into consideration the cell mask or the cytosol staining to see that this actually is a toxic compound, which just reduces cell size and it's cytotoxic. So bring this criteria into consideration, we started with, this shows actually all the wells in the screen, and we considered only compounds which did not reduce the cell area under a certain threshold and did not reduce cell number. And so we narrowed down our compounds and we had to have a polyglucosan mean intensity beyond a certain threshold as well. These were all calculated based on statistics that I won't go into. And eventually, we ended up with 85 compounds out of more than 10,000, which is the expected success rate or hit rate in high throughput screening, in HTS. Now, from these 85 compounds, we actually narrowed the list down even more by looking at the dose response. So we selected hits with the dose response, significant dose response, and also some hits which had a very nice effect, but did not show dose response, probably because we were not in the dynamic range. Then we took these hits and we tested them for independently, even in another lab, just to make sure that it's completely independent, in with my collaborator, Professor Minasian in Canada, and we looked at their effect on glycogen synthase activity. And indeed, 70% of the compound significantly reduced glycogen synthase activity. So we tried to make sense of these compounds. This is an interactome of the predicted protein targets of the hits that we find, the 11 plus 8, 19. And in this interactome, you can see in red protein targets that are actually, that interact with drugs and that, and also with carbohydrate derivatives, assuming they're more relevant for our pathways. Okay, and this is, this shows only the red circles that I showed you before, and this is the interaction of the hit targets, which are also interact with carbohydrate derivatives, and we, in the cluster analysis we did in collaboration with Hanoch Senderovich and in Bar-Ilan University, showed that all the hits we found actually were clustered with these drugs, and half of these drugs interact with glycogen synthase activator protein phosphatase. You know that glycogen synthase is activated by dephosphorylation. So we might have a possible mode of action, namely inhibition of protein phosphatase 1, the glycogen synthase activator. So now it's how do we get to a cure? In another screen in mouse cells, mouse model of mouse fibroblast, actually of APBD, done in Columbia University, they had some hits, and we tested their best hits for the effect on human cells, on patient cells, which is very, very important, because of course this is close to what you want. And these are the top scorers from the Columbia screen, Columbia University screen, and you can see that compound A, and sorry for not revealing the name for IP purposes, had a very impressive dose response, so we went forward with compound A, which also, and this is done in human cells, in patient cells, okay, in our screen, which is a, which is the assay that I developed, or we developed. And so we concentrated on compound A. We showed a nice inhibition of glycogen synthase. This was on, was done also on purified protein and in lysates. And now we looked at the mode of action. So, again, in collaboration with Hanoch Senderovich, who showed that actually the compound A docks into the active site of glycogen synthase, and you can look at the affinity. You can see that it's very close to the natural substrate, UDP glucose, which is a substrate of glycogen synthase. And UDP, sorry, this is UDP glucose, this is UDP. Okay, it's very close to UDP, not to UDP glucose. You can see the, so, which of course suggest competitive inhibition. And also, we saw increase in phosphorylation, which as I said is phosphorylation of glycogen synthase, which is inhibitory. Okay? So it increased actually both, it should have both a competitive and an allosteric effect, this new compound A. And these were exactly our kinetic results. So you can see that when we use a purified enzyme, compound A is actually a competitive inhibitor. And when you use lysate, it actually is a mixed inhibitor, which makes sense because it is a combination of competitive and allosteric inhibitor. So this acts exactly according to expectations. And then once we figure out the mechanism, we moved on to the mice, a mouse model of APBD, which is a knock-in mutation. And you can see that it decreased glycogen content only in the liver. Okay, so in accordance with being a glycogen synthase inhibitor, and the rest of the data were also in accordance with a putative glycogen synthase inhibitor, reduced glucose tolerance that you can see here, increased blood levels of glucose after fasting. And then we looked at the pathogenic factor, polyglucosan, and interestingly enough, it was able to reduce polyglucosan's level very nicely, but only in the liver. Okay? It didn't have an effect on brain polyglucosans. And also a possible caveat of this compound, of course, is the insulin resistance and increased gluconeogenesis because you inhibit glycogen synthase. So this is something to think about for the future for possible complications, which are, by the way, manageable. Yet, even though it affected polyglucosans only in the liver, what drove us to actually initiate, and now we initiate clinical trials, so based on high throughput screening, we have clinical trials in this using compound A. So what convinced us was that it completely recovered the lifespan of the mice. Okay, and this, our experts tell us, is a very good sign. It also corrected penile prolapse in male mice without any side effects, and so we don't expect it to completely cure the disease, but definitely ameliorate. So now it's in clinical trials. So how do we move from, this is an example of a drug which is developed by HTS. Now I want to move on to see how can we personalize these drugs, such as in the example that I showed you. So in the Blavatnik centers, in Miguel's lab, they do high content screening. How does it work? For instance, in APBD, as I showed you, the assay looks for polyglucosans, but also many other cell features, and as a matter of fact, all the cell features, cell shape, membrane, nucleus, ER, as you can see here. So it's not only the pathogenic factor that we look at. We look at all the plethora of cell features which can be analyzed by imaging. But just look at the image of the cell. So it's a multi-parameter analysis, and as I said, the hits don't affect only the polyglucosans. They can, we take a naive approach, actually, I should say, with Miguel, we take a naive approach which looks at the effect of any hit or any drug that you test on all the parameters of the cell. For instance, here, you can see four different Lafora patients, one of them with Malon mutation and three others with Laforin mutation and APBD, and we can compare them. So we can, what we can ask is what is unique to APBD in comparison to other neurodegenerative diseases? What is unique to APBD in comparison to other storage diseases, to other glycogen storage diseases? So you can see that we can focus the effect of any drug or any treatment that we test and see how it is peculiar to the condition that we want to treat it with, okay? And so what is common to all neurodegenerative diseases? What is common to glycogen storage diseases that differentiates them? And we can do this also at the level of a patient. What is unique to this patient which differentiates it from other patients or differentiates it from healthy subjects and so on? For instance, in this example, you can see that, and I think this is was shown by Miguel before, well, there is a reduction in lysosomes, okay? How is this related to a glycogen storage disease? Well, I will tell you later on with the Pompe example, but before that, this is just to illustrate again a bar plot, which is a similar one was shown by Miguel before, where we have actually the same patients that I showed you before. So three Lafora disease patient, one Lafora disease patient with Malin mutation, and APBD patient. And just by looking, without even the statistical analysis, this is normalized to the control, so it actually shows deviation from healthy. And you can see that this red patient, just by looking at it, you can see that the profile is a little bit different. If you look at all the cellular parameters, it stands out that this patient is different, and it's even APBD patients are even more similar to the other Lafora patients than this Lafora patient is to the other Lafora patients. So, and indeed, when we asked the pediatric who treats this patient, he said, yes, with cognition, she is different. Okay, her cognition is actually, in this case, a bit better than the other patients, but there is something different, so you want to look at the DNA, but you know from this analysis that this is something different in this patient, and therefore, you can go to personalized medicine and just treat her with a unique drug, which is special for her. So, I said before, maybe we shouldn't look at under the lamp. And this is a work that I collaborated with Nina Rabin from the NIH. And in this work, we looked at Pompe disease, looked at myotubes from Pompe disease mouse model. And you can see that if we look at the calcium, okay, the reactive oxygen species and the membrane potential, these three parameters were affected by verapamil. Okay, so verapamil, a blocker of calcium channel, actually affected the most important intercellular parameters in these cells, not only calcium, but also reactive oxygen species and the depolarization of the mitochondrial membrane. Which are known to be pathogenic. So how does a glycogen storage disorder leads to calcium dysregulation? Who knows? Perhaps by beta-adrenergic receptor, inhibition of mTOR signaling, who knows what is the pathway? But apparently, calcium channel blocker actually affects glycogen storage disease. And in mice, we showed that it actually also improves the clinic in the mice. And it is an early, this occurs early in the pathological cascade. Okay, so perhaps if you treat patients, children at a very early age with verapamil, you can prevent later on the effects. Okay, so this is a very important message. You can have many different parameters in every disease. And Pompe disease is caused by lysosomal glycogen accumulation. APBD is caused by cytosolic polyglucosan accumulation. But while this happens, and it may be pathogenic later on as the disease progresses, there are other things that happen. Glycogen storage disorder can lead to calcium dysregulation. Maybe calcium dysregulation is more important pathologically. We have to release ourselves, as Professor Munich said in the beginning, from dogmatic thinking. We have to be naive and open to all the possibilities, and this will facilitate drug discovery. Okay, and indeed, actually, if we look at Pompe, there is a considerable amount of genes which change that are related to calcium dysregulation, and this is a glycogen storage disorder. Okay, so How do we make personalized drug? First of all, classification. We use multiparametric phenoscores and machine learning to predict when you're given a certain cell, whether it's sick or healthy. Okay, so the first step is to classify cells as sick or healthy cells. And then, using machine learning, sick cells look different and the healthy cells. Each one of them is unique. So the machine learning can tell us whether this cell is healthy and whether the other cell is sick. And the personalized approach of drug screening is to tell you how individuals' disease phenotype turn into individual healthy phenotypes, because the healthy phenotypes are also different among themselves. But you have to know, to recognize by machine learning, which is sick and which is healthy, and how can any drug bring a global sick phenotype to a global healthy phenotype. So this is, I end here. We developed a high throughput screening assay which enabled us to validate previous screens and identify new hits, and we just received a grant to test these hits in mice. These are validated by their effect on glycogen synthesis, and we have a novel personalized approach to personalize a drug by applying a global comparison of cellular parameters within and among diseases. Okay, let me just acknowledge, we have many collaborators, of course, Miguel Weil and his group here at the Blavatnik, Ochan Ackman at Columbia University, in Canada, Benjamin Asian, the clinician who treats the APBD patients, Alex Lossos, Hanoch Sonderovich, in Bar-Ilan, and Nina Rabin in NIH for the work on Pompe, and thank you very much for your attention.